Let's keep going. So we talk about the memory. Memory is hippocampus required. This process, short-term to long-term memory, hippocampus required. And last time we talked about the molecular level, that's the glutamate, that's the neurotransmitter required. And you're going to form the synapse. And repetition is the key. And also sleep help. It turned out it's not exactly like HM could not learn anything. And this is one experiment they ask HM to learn, even though he does not remember. So you will draw the line between those two stars. So every time you go out, it counts as one arrow. It's actually not so easy because they actually cover this part. It takes the clothes off to let you see it. Actually cover this part. So you have to use the mirror to see the mirror and guide your hand to draw the line between those two stars. So it's not easy. And they train HM to do this. And after 2 months, he's very good at this task. He's going to draw the line so fast by looking in the mirror. And he will say, why this is so easy? I've never done it before. But actually, he have trained it for 2 months. He just don't remember it. So because of HM, they found memory is not just one kind of memory. You have different kind of memory. And there's another test performed by this doctor. Not to HM, but to other patients, similar, they receive hippocampus removed. It's in the hospital, so the doctor going to find the needle. It's very easy to find the needle. Going to put the needle here and ask the patient, okay, let's shake the hand. And after shake the hand, the patient is very angry and say, oh, okay, well, I'm going to sue you, right, because the needle is there. Because the patient could not form any new memory, so the patient went back home, slept, and forgot, so he never got sued. But the interesting thing is, the next week when the patient come back, the doctor moved the hand out, and the patient could not think why, but the patient refused to shake hand with the doctor. It's like the brain tried to tell him something, he just could not remember. This person is dangerous. Don't shake hand with this guy. He's not good. I just could not remember why. And we have different kind of memory. So the one HM lost, or that person who shook hand with doctor lost, is we call it explicit memory. Explicit memory is the memory you're able to use word to explain it. And apparently HM lost this. This is the hippocampus required. But the one he did not lose is the implicit memory. So he can still learn something. And implicit memory, sometimes you found some textbook called the motor memory. Like you learn how to ride a bicycle. And after you master it, and you hadn't ride a bicycle for a long, long time, and I throw you a bicycle, you can still ride it. Or you learned how to swim. And then after middle school, you never swim anymore. But one day I throw you into the pond. Okay, you are able to swim. And that's the implicit memory. This memory, you don't need to use word to tell people how you're able to do that. Like if I ask you how you're able to swim, well, you could not use the word to teach people how to swim. And that's this kind of memory, implicit memory. So HM still have this. And we have different kind of memory. And the one HM lost is called explicit memory. Okay, our last topic, let's talk about sleep. Sleep, so the story of sleep is people used to think sleep is like you shut down the brain. So your brain has so many neurons and like so many lights. Saying you just turn off the light one by one. And then the scientists say it's not true because when you go to sleep, you dream. So your brain must have some level of activity. And scientists used to think sleep, the why we have to sleep is because to conserve energy. And until recently, the scientists found you actually don't conserve too much energy. You go to sleep, your brain is very active. And you only conserve about 170 calories. 170 calories is about one small can of Coke. A small can of Coke is 150 calories. And you trade in a big risk. You stay unconsciousness for 7-8 hours. And during those 7-8 hours, a lot of animals, if you think about those people millions of years ago, a lot of animals can attack you. So it doesn't make much sense. And the recent theory of sleep is when you go to sleep, your brain is actually more activated compared with when you're awake. And why your brain becomes so activated? Because they are rehearsal what you learned in the daytime. So that's why you need to have a good quality of sleep. So when you go to sleep, your brain is not doing nothing. They are more activated. And also, your brain, when you go to sleep, is they are able to remove those garbage your brain create. So they create a lot of waste particle because your brains only weigh about 2% of your body weight. It takes about 15 to 20% of your blood flow. So it creates a lot of waste particles. And when you go to sleep, that's when your brain is doing the garbage cleaning work. So you're going to clean your brain. So good quality of sleeping is very important. And till the mid-20th century, they have the EEG. EEG is like the head, and they put on, it records the electrical activity from the brain. So people in the study sleep, they will ask the subject, okay, put the EEG on and go to sleep. So those people, they study sleep, those scientists, they all know sleep is important, but they all sleep deprived because when the subject goes to sleep, they have to stay awake, measure them. So they all look 10 years older compared with other scientists because they are sleep deprived. And this is what they found. So when you are awake, you found it's noise. And the reason is you have 100 billion of neurons and they don't fire synchronously. They don't fire synchronously, they cancel each other out, so all you have is noise. But when you go to sleep, you go to different stage. So you go to deeper sleep, you found, okay, the wave is bigger. The wave is bigger. Means they work harder, but they fire more synchronously. And remember last time I told you in neuroscience, they say, the scientists say neurons, when neurons fire together, wire together. So that's how they build the connection. At the molecular level, those synapse is where your memory is stored. So it helps you to organize the knowledge you learned in the daytime and organize them and form your knowledge, your memory. So the deeper state you sleep, and actually they have bigger waves. And every night, say you sleep 7-8 hours, that's what happened. So you are awake, you go to sleep, you go to stage 1, stage 2, you go deeper, and will come back to stage 1. Why go back to stage 1? That's when you are dreaming. So when you are dreaming, they call it REM, rapid eye movement. That's when the subject eye quickly move to the left and right, left and right. And if they wake the subject up, they will tell you, oh, I'm dreaming. So when you're dreaming, actually your brain activity is very similar when you're awake. So your brain is very active. But when you go to the deep sleep, well, they become more synchronized. So every night you will go follow this pattern. You go to the deep sleep and you go dreaming. And you go to the deep sleep, you go dreaming again. And you dream about 4, 5, 6 times. Most people only remember the last dream before they wake up. So you actually dream 4 or 5 times per night. And they talk about this, they say this is a good quality of sleep. So you have a deep sleep and you repeat these cycles. When people have mental disease is, it's not just they look depressed. Say people have depression or people have PTSD. And normal people, we go through this cycle, right? You go to the deep sleep, you go to dream, and repeat this cycle a few times. And people with depression, excuse me, they will quickly go to the deep sleep, and they go to dream much faster compared with normal people. And then suddenly they become awake in the middle of night. And they become awake, they don't know what they can do because they're completely awake. So this totally interrupts their sleep-awake cycle. And when you interrupt the sleep cycle, their body cannot recover. So eventually they look sick. They look sick and their immune system become weaker. They become sick. They look sick. Excuse me. So people get with depression, they not just look mentally, they look physiologically, they are unhealthy. So that's an example, your psychology affects your physiology. Your mind, your brain, your body, they all affect each other. Okay, that's it. See you next time.